to live next to Gypsies.
Two worlds that don't see eye to eye.
A horse in a garage on a housing estate is not normal.
Unable to live together.
They're not from our community.
They're humans, but they don't live like humans.
Dog was on site, she don't like us in houses. He likes to be in a gas chamber and beat gas.
Hey, Tara, it's all the same brush. Absolutely disgusting.
When two cultures collide.
I have nothing against travellers. I have a problem with people who don't abide by the law.
Communication breaks down.
We can't get no more Gypsy than this, can you?
Can travellers and the rest of Britain ever live together?
To use the word parasite might be really hard. In some ways, that's what they are.
Will relationships ever improve?
We all can get on. Give us a chance, and we can get on.
I'd be ashamed of myself if I did this to people.
Or will the Gypsies and travellers be pushed even further away?
Yum, yum!
This week...
This is the Kinky Nana.
English traveller Tony opens a new business.
Hello, Colin.
But faces a fight for his freedom.
I really hope I don't go to prison.
They're like my bars, let me out!
Mum of seven, Margaret...
Rocky!
...becomes the poster girl for Ireland's housing crisis.
How many poor innocent people have died on the streets this year?
And the biggest traveller funeral ever...
Number one!
...brings a town to a standstill.
Up to 1,000 travellers here tonight. I mean, how do you deal with that?
English traveller Tony has been dreaming of a new life for him and his children.
I've got 5 kids, 3 with one lady and 2 with the other.
Tony's never had a place of his own.
He's never really settled. It's his chance to have somewhere where it's his.
But this dream has just come crashing down.
Look here. I can't believe it. We've now got to go to High Court.
They're worried about him turning into a Gypsy caravan site.
So for now, Tony is focusing on a new venture with non-traveller Colin.
Looking good now, isn't it?
This is a 1400 turbo. It's the best one in the whole of Europe.
They're opening a new tanning salon in Ascot.
Well, it's taken 3 months.
And it still ain't that actually done yet. But once it's done, you can't put a price on perfection.
Millionaire Colin has no qualms about going into business with English traveller Tony.
People have said about Tony, and you've got to watch him. I've never had to watch my back room myself, ever.
I wish I knew how to do that computer system. I'd have a sunbed while I was here now.
I know how to do it. I was on here the other day like a genie.
That's youngster stuff, the computer. That's what we've got, Tony.
In the Gypsy world, we get brought up to always stick to your own. You don't trust, do business with anyone outside of the community.
How many minutes you on?
I don't know, 10?
Yeah.
Even though Colin's a gorger and I'm a traveller, I wouldn't be doing this right now if it wasn't for Colin.
Well, just push the button, Tony.
Why is it working?
The right one, not the wrong one.
What? Hello, Colin.
Hello, I pushed that.
Pushed that.
There's only one thing that they have to have. Trust.
Respect.
Have trust.
And love.
Oh, love him.
He's the best, isn't he?
Love,
love.
Oh,
I ain't going any
more.
I've had enough.
The finish line's coming close. For me and for him, it's a little bit uncharted water.
I'm getting nervous as it comes towards
it. I'm shitting myself.
Like Tony, 28-year-old Irish traveller Margaret also grew up on a site.
Mummy!
She lives on the outskirts of Dublin.
Johnny, why did you not bring your jacket?
And is a single mum of 7.
I think it's going to rain.
But 2 years ago, Margaret was evicted by her gorger landlord.
I had a house with a 5-year lease and my landlord went into bankruptcy and the house was repossessed.
She spent time being passed around emergency accommodation.
What are you doing?
Until ultimately the worst happened.
I had been referred to by the council to sleep in the Garda station on the floor, just benches. I put them on Facebook and in the hope that somebody would get onto the council, but it just went viral.
Margaret's plight had become national news. And her story caught the eye of fellow traveller and activist Bernard Sweeney.
Margaret Cash popped up on social media. Margaret was more or less asking and pleading to the world around her, like, I mean, I have no one. I have no one to support me, no one to help me.
I remember thinking, oh my God, what have I done? Like, people were going into my Facebook page and they were printing a lot of bad stuff.
The negative Blame the mother, blame the traveller, blame the background, blame the culture. This has gone on with travellers all over the country for a very, very long time.
I remember thinking, right, will I shut up? And then I said, no, I'm not going to shut up.
Determined to keep a roof over her children's heads, Margaret is struggling with the chore of emergency housing.
When you're out that door at 8 a.m, yeah, you're not coming back till after 9:30 that night. So you're walking all that length of time.
And even getting the kids to school is difficult.
It takes almost 2 hours, and I have to get 3 different buses in the morning, 3 different buses back. People say, I'll just change schools. Why should I put my children out somewhere where they're happy and they're accepted there?
You begin to think, why is this happening to me? No, it's not good enough, I'm good. Rocky! Rocky!
Margaret wants her voice to be heard. And at a large event in Dublin, she might just have her chance.
So sad to see that. My children never know what it's like to be a traveller. So there's a protest tomorrow. And I'm going to go and let people know what's going on. Just had enough of it.
In Ascot, Tony is also keen to get the word out about his new salon.
Do you want to leave the opening party down to me?
That's your area, mate.
So are we going to have a 50-50 gypsy gorge rule here?
You invite whoever you want to get here,
so,
mate.
So just invite the beautiful one?
Yeah.
With loads of money?
That's it, the beautiful one's loads of money.
What, both sides?
All sides, every side, everywhere right, we can get the money, my friend.
Tony's business life seems to be coming together. But there's a stumbling block that could threaten his big plans.
I've got a big day ahead of me. I've got Crown Court. For driving.
When I heard that he'd done it, I thought, what an idiot.
Tony had a police chase. He panicked. He drove off, he tried to get away, didn't get away, and then handed himself in.
For once in my life, I've got a straight business. We've got an establishment here now, which makes me secure, and everything was going to plan. The last time I had a driving issue, I had to do community service.
Put that in there.
So I'm hoping they give me that. I've got to take my bag just in case, but I'm just hoping, please, that I walk out of that court.
In England, there's been a death that has sent shockwaves through the traveller community.
It's hard to believe the betrothed, Jim. It's not fair.
Irish traveller Mikey Connors was just 32.
Oh, he's filly, boys, yeah, a filly, look.
But was already considered a legend amongst his community.
Throughout the UK and Ireland, wherever you go, everybody would know Mikey Connors.
He could sing. Young men looked up to him.
Good sportsman. Good businessman. Throughout the whole country, he was known as one of the best trotting men out there.
He was the best at everything.
Mikey died doing the thing he loved. Road racing on his sulky when he was struck by a car.
He only went out to race his horse that morning. It was that middle stable there he took his horse out, Tony Montana. That was it, that was the last time he was here.
Father of two and a loyal family man, he leaves behind 5 sisters and 1 brother, 21-year-old Simey.
The only brother, you know, he was just a proper all-around man. Wish I could be as half as man as him, or as quarter as man as him, but all I can do is try and follow his footsteps, you know? There's not more than that I can do.
Mikey was a successful businessman.
He won the awards 2017, 2018, twice, for best businessman in Surrey.
But he had a secret. In order to win the awards, he felt he had to hide his traveller identity from his clients.
If you know you are one, obviously it kind of sets the mark about back a bit, you know? That's the kind of stereotypes you get.
But in the traveller community, everyone knew and loved Mikey, so huge numbers are expected at his funeral next week.
Believe me, nearly every traveller in the UK and Ireland will more or less be at this funeral.
The family have enlisted the help of the community's most trusted undertaker, Paul Brown.
Mikey's funeral, probably the biggest funeral I've ever had to organise. The amount of money that's been spent is immense. It's unbelievable, everything is just so personal to him.
So I wanted the best for Mikey. Because he was such a good man, he deserves the best, don't he?
Paul organised Mikey's grandfather's funeral just last year.
You now stand, please.
the local town ground to a halt, while Simey Doherty was honoured by his family. And this funeral is taking place at the same church.
At the church for this funeral, the road is so narrow that it's difficult to get any of the cars through or public transport.
With thousands of mourners expected to attend, will this sleepy town be brought to a standstill again?
It's their funeral. They're not bothered what they do, what they block off, who they upset. That's how it is.
Across the water in Ireland, Margaret is making her way to the Raise the Roof homeless protest.
Everybody, watch the road!
Irish traveller Bernard wants Margaret to speak on the stage today.
One of the things I had noticed in a number of protests, we found a lot of politicians speaking. What was missing was people who were actually homeless from being up on the stage.
Mum, we're going to head to the bus stop now, quick. We're ready to fight. I'm only messing.
There are thousands expected at this protest. A perfect opportunity for Margaret to be heard.
Do you want to go in front of that? At the end of the day, your voice is far more important than 10 people living in a home.
At the culmination of the march, the official speakers are in full swing.
Travellers are 11 times more likely to become homeless than the settled population.
They're up there. How do they know that they're being homeless?
Bernard sees this as Margaret's opportunity.
I'm really going to push very hard for Margaret to have the voice up on that stage. I was hoping maybe to get Margaret up at some stage for 5 minutes.
Unfortunately, the organisers refuse.
You see, they don't want us speaking. The government doesn't want to hear from us.
But Margaret is offered another chance by one of the protesters.
How many poor innocent people have died on the streets this year? In the hands of you, I am laughing! In your hands! How many people?
These people let me speak on the mic. And when they did, the music went on full blast. So we had to shout.
If Margaret had been a settled person, she would be the poster child of the national Irish housing crisis. The fact she was travellers, she doesn't fit the criteria.
It's the controversy that surrounds Margaret they're afraid of. So that's why we had her speak with us today, because we're not afraid of controversy. We love it.
The protest is over, and Margaret is no closer to getting the home she needs.
We're all entitled to the home.
In Leigh for Ealing, West London, battle lines have been drawn. On one side, unauthorised traveller encampments. And on the other, Ealing councillor Joanna.
The issue of legal encampments started a few years ago where the frequency increased. In the last 3 years, we had roughly one a week.
It's been going on for several years now. My concerns were the mess. The litter, the excrement, human excrement. I mean, it really is absolutely disgusting.
Since 2012, there's been an estimated 160 unauthorised encampments throughout the borough of Ealing. So Joanna has taken things into her own hands.
So I propose to have a borough-wide injunction in order to deter people from camping out on commons or other public land.
If successful, Joanna's injunction would make it illegal to stop on council and public land.
I have nothing against travellers. I have absolutely no problem with their chosen lifestyle. I have a problem with people who don't abide by the law.
This morning, Joanna gets word from the locals about the latest unauthorised encampment.
Residents are very vigilant and they keep me abreast of what's going on, probably 24/7. Unfortunately, we have an unauthorised encampment on the south side, on the southern common. As we can see, there's a lot of tyre tracks that have literally driven onto the common, so they're ruining the common for everybody else.
Joanna visits each encampment to document their scale.
There are about, this time, about a dozen. I can't see any rubbish. Hopefully no cleanup costs here, or not extreme. There will be costs, not just financial, to the actual common.
But as she prepares to leave, she's flagged by a car.
They splashed my car over there.
Even look on the bumper on the front, it's a scratch. I don't know who done, but it's happened today.
Will you be reporting to the police?
Because if yes, I'm going to report this because look,
please report.
That's right.
And as they're talking, Another car pulls up.
The driver's door and my wing mirror has all been hit.
It was all right this morning, though, when I popped up. The first thing I did before I get out is check, make sure the car and stuff's OK. But I reckon it'd probably be where they're turning maybe the caravan around. And I'm going to be the one that's have to pay out for it. It's frustrating, isn't it? It's annoying.
Unfortunately, antisocial behaviour is experienced by many, whether it's residents or visitors like the gentleman we just spoke, who innocently parked his car because he works nearby, and he comes back to a scratched vehicle.
Though there is no proof it was anyone from this encampment, Joanna is keen to help her residents.
I'm quite passionate about making sure my residents are safe and secure in their homes and without a fear of crime.
With that in mind, Joanna has started a petition to drum up local support for her injunction.
I didn't see any other elected colleague from any party doing anything, so I thought, let me do this. I sort of had to take it into my own hands.
And in only a matter of weeks, it's overflowing with signatures.
Over 1,500 residents of Ealing Borough have signed. Now I can actually present the petition to full council to hopefully get the request to have an injunction against such an encampment passed.
Someone else hoping to get the locals on side is English traveller Tony.
I thought probably I'd see you. Just come in, say hello.
Hi, Tony.
You're looking well, mate.
How you doing?
He's visiting old friends Tony and Karen, who live next door to Tony's proposed new yard.
Sorry about all the grief what's going on at the minute with everything.
He wonders if they've heard anything from the other neighbours.
Somebody from the residents of the street are worried about it being an illegal gypsy caravan site.
It's got to be someone that doesn't know you.
I don't know, big one of the street yard. Feels like somebody's got in for me down here.
I think what it is, a lot of people don't know what you like, but we know you from 6-7 years ago. And you've always been the same, and you've been brilliant.
Oh, hopefully it'll get sorted.
I'm worried to death about it, but do you know what? I'm happy that you are my neighbours. I really am, because at least there's no pressure or animosity.
Come and show me what you've done down there, Tony.
Tony's neighbours don't want the land developed by anyone. They say it's for environmental concerns.
This is the enforcement letter. Upon hearing, consult the defendant. I don't know. We'll go through it later. I can't really read and it's embarrassing, isn't it?
That's freestyling.
The court order means Tony's new chalet can no longer be delivered to this yard.
Yeah, yeah. Nice. The one I've got is locked up in this one.
Really?
So it's stuck on the back of a lorry.
This would be brilliant for you, wouldn't it?
Yeah, built for the kids.
Though Tony has the support of next door, the other neighbours' complaints continue to surface.
I would like to know what's been ruffling their feathers so much, though. You haven't heard anything?
I've heard, actually. What they say, they tried to get the chalet in,
yeah,
but there was a car in the way. So you say it was bumped to the middle of the road, you know what I mean?
What, one of the people that lived down the road?
Well, their car, so they say.
Their car?
Yeah. The woman wasn't very happy at all.
I wasn't here the day that it went in. Yeah. So if I would have been here, I would have made sure that obviously no one would have had their car touched. Definitely not. But that's telling me that anyway, because without knowing that, that could be the reason, one of the reasons.
Maybe.
Anyway.
But a car-related incident that Tony was present for was his failure to stop.
It'd be my luck, I'd be ended up back behind the bars.
No. There'd be Tony! I can't take the pressure! I wonder what the sunbed shop's doing!
Back in Ireland, Irish traveller Bernard has come up with a way for traveller issues to be heard.
We're going to launch Travision.
He's running a traveller-specific TV channel, and today's launch day.
We're eager to get this thing up and running.
Bernard wants Margaret to speak first.
Basically, I'm coming to talk about my experience and the whole homeless issue and this government and everything else, like, so see how it goes. Hopefully it should be good.
Hiya, Bernard.
Welcome. Get set up, here we are now.
Margaret's going to be sat next to politicians and journalists.
Welcome to Travision.
All around the country, travellers are living in appalling conditions.
And now everyone will hear Margaret.
There's children walking the streets day and night and not knowing where they're going to sleep. Now, that's not just travellers that's doing that. That's the whole, every homeless person in Dublin that's doing it. You're either going to live like this forever or you have to get up and talk.
Hopefully stay tuned, we'll be back to you guys very soon. Thank you very much.
I think about okay. It's only a start, so hopefully it'll grow.
But TV stardom aside,
somebody's ringing.
The call she's been waiting years for comes in.
So did I get her? When would you like me to come in? Wonderful. Thank you very much, Leanne. We have to go for an interview on a house on Monday. I think I got a house. I think so.
Really?
Yeah. Well done. It's still only temporary, but...
Are you hopeful?
If she didn't want me to go in about her, she wouldn't have rang me, would she?
After years of moving each night and spending her days walking the streets with seven children, Margaret could finally have a house of her own.
Yeah, I am hopeful. Very hopeful.
In Surrey, Simey and his family have gathered to pay their last respects to Mikey Connors. The family will be delivering Mikey to the church for a Catholic wake this evening, ahead of the funeral tomorrow. But first, the family are gathering for a procession around Mikey's field, a special place to him. These are his last moments at home. Before they leave, Simey has something special planned. He's swapping places with the hearse for one final lap of honour. And let's rip.
I was constantly being asked to speed up because the horse was catching up with me because I wasn't driving quick enough. I found it interesting, to say the least.
We're just celebrating his life, you know, his memory, you know.
The family have said their goodbyes and the wake procession makes its way to the church, where huge numbers have already gathered outside. This unusually large turnout is an indication of scale for the funeral tomorrow.
Due to how popular he was, what he did, his age, this is probably one of the biggest travel funerals you'll ever see.
In Surrey, it's the night before Mikey's funeral, and the family are on their way to the church. In keeping with their Catholic faith, they will be delivering Mikey's casket for the wake service.
On the night before, it's a wake, so you have to bring the body into the chapel and you gotta leave it there for a night, and you say Mass.
But while the family are inside the church, outside, the funeral cars have caused chaos for the residents of the road. Leaving Paul and his team to deal with frustrated locals.
We've got no control on where people park their vehicles. So therefore, when it happens, we have to make the best of what situation we've got.
Well, we need to move this up a bit, don't we?
It's normal that people get angry, frustrated, you know, thinking, what next going off here? But up to 1,000 travellers here tonight, I mean, how do you deal with that?
With even more people expected tomorrow, will the locals allow the chaos to continue?
Tomorrow will be some turnout. You know, we've got 16 white Rolls Royce. It could go one way or other, but I think it's just a case of let it happen in the most respectful way it can.
In Surrey, Tony is opening his first ever business venture in 7 days' time.
Hey, what's happening? I can't believe it still ain't ready yet, though.
The kitchen's going in this week, so yeah. By the end of this week, mate, open for business.
The finish line's coming close. I'm excited to open the shop. There's been a lot of interest. Hopefully, week 10 days and we should be open.
Tony's ex-partner, Danielle, is also feeling positive about the new business.
Kinky Nana's a good business idea. I think they've done really well with it. Like, I'm generally really pleased about that.
But after years in an on-off relationship, Danielle has learnt there can be two sides to her ex.
He craves the family life. Rudy, your dinner's ready. But then he never calms down. He's out of control. That's why I can't be with him. Tony's his own worst enemy. He really tries to pull it together and do the right things by everyone. But then he's always got that other side to him, which is really wild. He just will never tame himself.
And it's his wild side that's come back to bite him with his court case looming.
It's going to be, hopefully, my last skeleton in my closet, and I'm just hoping I walk out of that court and I can carry on my crusade with the beauty, making Ascot beautiful.
In Ealing, it's the day of reckoning for Joanna and her campaign against unauthorised encampments.
We're here tonight to present a petition that over 1,500 residents of Ealing Borough have signed to get an injunction against unauthorised encampments. We're here now to debate the petition at full council, a bit like Parliament, but on a local level.
If successful tonight, she will have the council's full support to get the injunction over the line.
I am pleased that my petition has triggered enough signatures for debate tonight. It seems that Ealing has the second highest number of recorded unauthorised encampments, totalling over 160. I urge the council to accept the petition and investigate applying to the courts for an injunction. Thank you.
Joanna's case presented, it's now up to the councillors to debate the issue.
Sir, Mr. Mayor, we call on the council to back this petition.
After strong support from fellow councillor David Milliken, next up is a councillor from an opposing party.
Do not believe that the petition before us tonight is the correct way forward.
After a lively debate, a decision is finally reached.
Mr. Mayor, I do not consider an injunction as outlined in the petition provides an appropriate solution at this stage.
The council have decided not to support the injunction, but they have suggested an alternative.
They've only committed to putting railings and ditches round a common which happened to be my ward. However, for the remainder of the borough, and it's the third largest borough in London, they're doing nothing.
Joanna has put an awful lot of effort into organising this petition. I would think she's pretty disappointed.
I'm not sure if it's a political or a legal point of view. They are resisting an injunction, which I'm quite surprised about. We can't change history. We can't change the past. So let's look forward. We have to start looking positively rather than fighting. I don't want any community to feel to be the victim. Let's actually step forward and work together.
Five weeks ago, homeless traveller Margaret received some encouraging news.
The council had told me that there was an association called Sophia Housing and that there was a house available. I was really excited and I was really happy and all. The children were over the moon, but it just didn't work out. Basically, Sophia Housing wanted to have a short-term lease, say, of 6 to 8 months, and then they wanted the council to confirm that they would definitely have a home for me after that. So the county council wouldn't agree to that, and that's why the house fell through. It was just devastating for the children more than anything else, do you know what I mean? Because they thought they were getting a house.
Margaret's only lifeline has now been taken away from her.
And her shoes and her jacket. What? Under the stairs.
The council couldn't guarantee accommodation for a family as big as hers.
She said, there's just an awful lot more people on the list waiting ahead of you for 4-bed houses. But I'll take a 3-bed. They said, we can't give you a 3-bed. So would you happy enough to let me sit in a B&B in one room? You just got nowhere with them. Sick of fighting them, do you know what I mean?
With her latest disappointment, Margaret's friends are rallying around her.
Hi.
Hiya, Lisa.
Hiya, boys. How's
things? Hi, hon. Mwah. Great to see you.
Nice to see you. Can't cope anymore.
I know you can't, and it's horrific, I know that. But you have to be housed, keep going.
Yeah, well, I'm ready for the fight.
Margaret isn't letting this latest setback bring her down.
But right now, we're just taking it day by day and just doing what we've always been doing. It's hard, but we just have to do it, don't we?
After all she's been through, Margaret's fighting spirit is still strong.
One day we'll be at the council fighting them again. Having a house, Jesus Christ, just to get back into my own old routine. The children can actually go out and play with children on the road. You can put on their pot of dinner and wash their own old clothes in the washing machine. Stupid little things that means nothing, but means everything when you haven't got it.
It's the morning of the funeral, and Simey is making sure all is ready to lay brother Mikey to rest.
It's his burial today. Unbelievable hard, you know. He's only 32 years old, you know, and he got his life cut short. It's heartbreaking. It's unreal.
In the travelling community, the funeral reflects the man, so Simey has pulled out all the stops.
We've ordered 17 Rolls Royces here for my brother to take us to the chapel. We've got these gloves put in as a tribute to him. It's his last boxing gloves he ever put on. All I can do for him today is try and make him proud and, yeah, and do the best I can for him.
With expectations high, the pressure is on Undertaker Paul to make sure it all runs smoothly.
All the Rolls Royces are conveyed here to pick up the family and make our way to church. Service starts at 11 o'clock. Everything seems calm, everybody's mood right now, but who knows what could happen.
Word has spread of the funeral. And in Ashted, it's the talk of the town.
I heard it was happening. The word was, I think, round in the village and pick up all the gossip in the shops.
I knew him personally. He was coming in regularly. Such a great man.
I don't have a problem with them being here in the area today. I think the local pubs are shut, but that's all as far as I know. So it's whether they don't want big groups of people coming in and upsetting the locals.
Already there was a parking problem this road. There's now a parking problem.
We shouldn't see Gypsies as a different part of the community. They are part of the community. I think people should be patient about these kind of things.
Around the corner, the procession of 16 Rolls Royces is due to arrive any minute. It's time for Simey and family to make their way into the church service.
Well, I've never ever seen anything like it. We were just in shock because everything was at a standstill except this parade of limousines going by. We assumed it was the travellers' funeral because we'd never experienced anything like that.
While the family are paying their last respects, outside, the 16-car procession has again caused gridlock.
At the minute, you can see we've got 16 Rolls Royce blocking all the streets off. Local residents aren't happy, but there's just nothing we can do about that.
The family hope that the town can understand why Mikey deserves these grand gestures.
Had we known, we may have walked down here earlier.
I wonder if the police would close the road for Mikey.
But it appears that not everybody accepts the chaos that's been caused.
They double parked everywhere, didn't they? I mean, I understand it's a funeral, you've got to have respect, but at the same time, how are they going to get out?
And no one down here can get out.
It is completely chaos. I've been here nearly 1.5 hours.
People find it hard to understand why it's on this level and this big, but this person meant so much to this family and this community.
The service is finished, and with the locals looking on, the family take Mikey's coffin to the hearse.
We just put up in the air and just give him his last farewell, you know. Put up in the air and saying he's the best. Whatever you got inside, you let it out. Give him a shout and say, up Mikey Connors.
It's a completely different way of paying respect to the deceased from what we normally see.
The church service may be finished, but the day is far from over.
Now you're going home, Mikey. I love your only heart. Come on.
I
It'll be about another 15 minutes and then we'll be departing to go to Epsom Down Racecourse.
My boys, let's set the road. Go on, put that on.
Accompanied by Mikey's favourite song, the procession now heads to the next stage of this huge day. ...17 miles away, Tony's chalet has now finally arrived at the site he grew up on, and has been placed on breeze blocks on the ashes of his old home, right opposite his mum's.
This is the new chalet. This is what I've been so stressed out for. Could be the girls, could be the boys' room. It's already got a bed in there, but I'm gonna have to put some bunk beds in here for the kids.
The main thing is that I've got it here. It was on the back of a lorry the other day for a week.
I've done everything that I had to do for my kids. I want them to have a nice home, and their dad got it for them.
Though Tony continues to get the chalet ready for his kids, the reality of a possible jail term is now looming large.
I'm going to be gutted if I go to prison tomorrow. Literally gutted. I'm getting used to prison, and I already, look, they're like my bars, let me out! I'm just hoping that I haven't come out of there with these plans. I've done it all, and now they send me back in there. Oh, God. I really hope tomorrow I don't go to prison.
It's 10 a.m. and Tony's just arrived at Guildford Crown Court.
I'll just be happy to get this done, to be honest with you.
Today's the day he learns his fate.
I've got to go back in there for probation. They said I get sentenced at 2 o'clock.
He's being sentenced today for driving without a licence, dangerous driving and failure to stop for the police.
This is the long process now, the next couple of hours.
I've dreamed of having a life where I can wake up every day with no stress, no worries, no anxiety, no pressure, no question mark.
Let's just hope this goes well.
I'm hoping they give me community service, get to go back to normal life.
But because of the seriousness of the offences, the judge didn't look upon Tony as kindly as he had hoped. And he's sentenced to 10 months in prison. With Tony in jail, ex-partner Danielle is showing kids Rudy and Delilah the new chalet, in anticipation of his return in a few months' time.
So what do you think of Daddy's chalet then?
Good.
It's nice, isn't it? Did you pick which bedrooms you're going to stay in when he gets out? Go on then. Show us.
I sleep in here with my brother. It's got cupcakes. It's the toy bed.
So when Daddy's back, are you gonna have like sleepovers and stuff with him?
Yeah.
Honestly, like Tony always like wanted a family and children.
It's my turn to jump.
He cares about them a lot.
Look at that little cat.
Tony's always trying to get his life together, but this time, when I spoke to him, he is generally choked up and he really does want to turn over a new leaf. But I think what Tony says and what Tony does is two different things. I don't know, maybe prison will change that for him.
Danielle is hopeful that Tony can truly turn things around on his release. One thing he can count on, though, is a business to return to.
Tony is going to be absolutely gobsmacked when he comes out and he sees how it's transformed.
And a friend who will always have his back.
I have no regrets having Tony as a friend, 100%. I've got no regrets in anything I do with Tony. To me, it's a silly mistake he's done. It hasn't changed our friendship, it won't change anything me and him have got going on. We've just got to work through it together. Everyone will stand by him because it's Tony.
Across the county lines in Surrey, Mikey's funeral has moved on to Epsom. where it becomes clear just how popular a man he was. For the next stage, the travellers have blocked the roads, and the rest of the world will have to wait. For a tradition that started when Mikey was alive.
My granddad's funeral was last year, and basically, Mikey wanted to give him his last trot with his horse Taffy, so he done that there last year. And as soon as Mikey died, I knew what to do. The retrieve chair was the hardest moment and the most proudest moment to be on his horse Big T and go down that road and let that horse rip and him behind me.
Mikey's last ride is now complete. But Simey has one final surprise for his brother.
I look above me and I see a plane with bunting flying at the back of it saying, "Rest in peace, Mikey Connors." That was a wow factor for me because I've never seen that before.
With the road still blocked off for the public, the family transfer Mikey to a horse-drawn carriage to begin the final walk to the cemetery. Number one. Again, the family have pulled out all the stops in honour of Mikey.
There was thousands there. I've never seen a bigger funeral.
Mikey's funeral, it was quite moving. Once the casket was lowered, there was all sorts of emotion. There were people pushing around the grave. That's the end for him. That is the end, and they see that.
Quite a big thing in the traveller community, singing. If you sing at a grave, it's like you're singing true respect to that person. So whoever sung for Mikey on the day, it was shown strictly true respect to Mikey.
To witness one of these funerals, you can see that it's a celebration as well as sadness. You know, clapping, cheering.
In the travelling community, when you do something good, you don't be forgotten. We're very proud people in that way.
The pain in your heart never goes away.
But it was everything to me. Every day is just hard, you know, hard to get through things and do things without me running around. All I can do now is be strong. I've got five sisters, and all I can do is look after them and just do what I have to do, you know. I'd never be the man my brother was, but all I can do is try to be.
See you later, Mike. Love you.
He'll be greatly missed, but he'll never be forgotten. My brother Mikey Connors, he was just a legend, and that was it.
Next time...
I refuse to be an housewife.
English traveller Scarlett is pushing boundaries.
I will not slave on a man.
But there's tears before tiaras.
I just would hate that for my daughter.
In Ireland, relationships are breaking down.
This is an act of hatred.
And show no signs of improving.
The settler community, they want members of the traveller community to disappear.
And in Surrey...
They just bombed in, just one after the other.
Local residents have reached the end of their tether.
We will actually sit on them, and I mean sit on them.
The uprising is coming.
Don't miss all that next Thursday at 9. Exploring one of the wonders of the world, an emotional journey to India continues in Cruising with Jane McDonald, new tomorrow at 9. And tonight, revealing the shocking truth of heroin use in the UK. My Extreme Drugs Diary is new next.